Praise you, Lord. Amen. The privilege to praise Him.
Praise the Lord. Let's continue to worship. Where sometimes I play that keyboards and sometimes the notes come out right, sometimes they don't. But God is good in all things. Amen. At the cross is what we're going to sing now. I want this to be your prayer. And think about these words. And if you've never sang a note in the church, say these words out loud so you know, you can hear what you're saying. If you don't want to sing, say these words to the Lord Jesus.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, it comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus.
Amen. Listen.
There's a place where sin and shame
got on your
are
shirt
powerless. Where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white,
of the world. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. At the cross, we surrender our life this morning. We want to worship you in our offerings this morning. We want to give back cheerfully to you, Lord. Thank you for the gift of life. Thank you that we can stand bold in this world as a bright light. As the pastor said, as the world sometimes gets darker, we can be lighter and draw all men and women to you when we lift up the name of Jesus. So receive these offerings this morning and our tithes. Would you bless it, sir? And we thank you that you saved our lives for all eternity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You all be seated. We have help from God Almighty, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
There is a moment every heart needs a rescue. There is a season every soul needs a breakthrough. Help from heaven. We all need help from heaven. There is a whisper.
There is a whisper.
A voice of hope inside you. There is an answer.
There is an answer.
A name above to guide you. Help from heaven. We all need help from heaven.
Oh yes.
Help from heaven.
When the world is on our shoulders and we need a hand to hold us and no miracle is found, still believe. Oh, when the sea of night surrounds us and our questions try to drown us, just believe. Just believe in help from.
There is a reason.
There is a reason.
These tears have not been wasted. There is a future. For all these broken pieces, look to heaven. All we need is help from heaven. That's all we need.
All we need. When the road ahead is hidden and we need a new beginning, when the battle's closing in, still believe. Oh,
one more step into the promise and the hands of grace that hold us. Just believe.
Just believe.
Just believe. And help from.
Amen. Help from heaven. Should have made that the title of my message. And that's exactly what it's going to be about. Help from heaven. Two different people that I'm going to look at this morning, and two of them did two different things with two different outcomes. And help from heaven was apparent in one and it was different in the other. And so I want to read you this. It's one of my favorite, it's one of the only poems that I ever memorized in grammar school, but The Road Not Taken. The title of this message is One Decision Can Change a Life. Obviously, accepting Christ changes your eternity. One decision changing a life. But what about us as believers as we continue to live in this multiplicity of decisions and all the contingencies that are out there, and you start looking back, your life has been one system of choices, one after the other. That's what it's been. And those choices had cause and effect, and those different contingencies played out like a Venn diagram, and if you could see it from God's perspective, He knows all of it. Now, I want to read you the poem. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. That's an impossibility. And be one traveler long I stood, and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that passing there, had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to go, and that's a very important statement. Yet knowing how way leads on to way. I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. Two statements in here jump out at me. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, one decision leads to another. And he said, I doubted if I could ever come back. We can't come back to the place where we were when we were teenagers or when we were young adults or when we were first having our children, if you're a little over middle age and all those kind of things. There is no going back to that day. But he said he had a choice, and he took the road less traveled by. I want to challenge you this morning to take the road less traveled by. Two different people here in Isaiah chapter 7, and then we'll look at Isaiah chapter 36. One is King Ahaz, one is King Hezekiah. Now I want to divide this up and give you a little bit of an overview of the book of Isaiah for just a minute. Chapters 1 through 39 give us this Assyrian threat that was moving in the east against the nations in the south and west, which would have included all of Palestine, Samaria, Syria, Egypt, all of these countries. And it was a decision they had to make. Are they going to trust God or look to worldly pacts or coalitions, other nations to protect them? Are they going to move in a way that would be against God's will in order to find protection? Or are they going to trust God? Chapters 40 through 55 jump past this. Isaiah gives prophecies about the Babylonian exile. Now, in the first case, the exile to Assyria of the northern kingdom has not yet taken place. When Isaiah makes these prophecies about Judah, the north has already been lost, and he makes prophecies about the conquering kingdom of Babylon against the south, probably almost 100 years beforehand. Indicative of the fact that God does give us warning of things that are coming down the road in our lives in many cases, seeking to protect us. And then in chapters 56 through 66, the prophecies about the end time when God himself brings in his kingdom. Now, with that in mind, I want to give you a key verse And chapter 30 of 15 in Isaiah, he said, in returning and trust, ye shall be saved, but you were unwilling. In returning and trust, you shall be saved, but you were unwilling. Now I want to read you what I would say would be the synopsis, the thesis of this sermon in a different way out of another book in Jeremiah. Don't turn there, just listen. Jeremiah 17, verse starting in verse 5. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart turns away from the Lord. It's an impossibility to trust God and man at the same time. He is like a shrub in the desert and shall not see any good come. He shall dwell in the parched places of the wilderness in an uninhabited salt land. Then he goes on and he gives this contrast, this antithesis. Verse 7. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, who trusts is in the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the streams and does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and it's not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. Now there you go. Two roads diverging in the woods. One is trust in man, the other is trust in God. Now, I want you to see just a little, before I get into these two chapters, which we are going to read, I want you to think about the big picture. It's always better to get the big picture and then bring it down to the particulars. We are in the particulars, but what is the big picture here? The big picture is that God is sovereign over the universe. He controls all things, all human contingencies. He controls it all, and he's working it all to the glory of God, the removal of sin and destruction through his Son, Jesus Christ, for the ultimate blessings and peace and prosperity of his children. That's the big picture. Well, let's hone it down just a little bit. Involved in that big picture are individuals. Individual nations, cities, churches, businesses, families. Individuals. And we have a privilege, an opportunity to act in God's big plan, to fit in, to trust his promises, is to plug in the only path, the strength, peace, love, and lasting prosperity. To delight in his word is our one true direction, peace and joy in life. And to serve him, obey him, our one true privilege. But lastly, to resist and rebel against all of this is to ensure loss. It's to ensure disaster, destruction, and ultimately death in many ways. Now that's the big picture. And you say, well, that's a little dim. Well, let's get into it, and I think you're going to see another side to it. Let's begin to read in chapter 7, and we're going to see how these two men play out. In chapter 7 of Isaiah, in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, king of Judah, Rezin, king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, the king of Israel, came up to Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not yet mount an attack against it. When the house of David was told, I want you to hear this, Syria is in league with Ephraim. Now, if you look on a map, you're going to see those countries are bigger than Jerusalem and Judea, and they're in league together, so it's more than two against one here. And look at what it says. The heart of Ahaz and the heart of his people shook as the trees of the forest shake before the wind. Scared to death. Earthly intimidation. Earthly outnumbered. We're under the barrel. We are totally at the mercy of circumstances, it appears. But what did the Lord say to Isaiah? You go out and you meet Ahaz, you and Shear Jashub, your son. It's interesting. Sheer Jason's son in the Hebrew means there will be a remnant. And the end of the at the end of the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the washer's field, and say to him, be careful, be quiet. I want you to notice that. First of all, this is incredibly precise. Be careful. Every thought you think, every move you make is very important from this moment on. Be careful. Be quiet. We don't argue with the devil. Do not fear, and do not let your heart be faint. Because of these two smoldering stumps of firebrands, at the fierce anger of Rezin in Syria and son of Remaliah, because Syria with Ephraim and the son of Remaliah has devised evil against you, saying, now God knows their hearts, and he's telling it to Ahaz through Isaiah. Let us go up against Judah and terrify it. Terrify it. And let us conquer it for ourselves and set up the son of Tabeel as king in the midst of it. Thus says the Lord God. Now that's what man says. That's what man's planning in his heart. What does God say about it? It shall not stand. And it shall not come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin. And within 65 years, Ephraim shall be shattered from being a people. And it was conquered in 722. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is the son of Remaliah. But he says this, if you're not firm in your faith, Ahaz, listen, you shall not stand. You will not be firm in the Hebrew. You won't be firm at all. If you're not firm, you won't be firm. In any way. See, unbelief destabilizes every part of your life. Not just your decision making, but every part of your life. It is a cancer. And it moves in with fear. And it causes us to make mistakes and choices out of fear, decisions that will destabilize us even more. But God has a rescue, and he wants us to trust in him. But what did Ahaz do? He could join this pack and give in to Ephraim and Syria and fight Assyria on that basis and perhaps maybe stand a better chance. Or he could turn to Assyria and say, come protect me against these enemies. Or he could trust God and not be afraid at all and let God do something. What did he do? What did he do? Well, sadly, he turned to Assyria. And he invited them in. And I'm not going to give you all the passage here, but he basically said, I want you to come and attack Israel and attack Syria. And I want you to do that for me, and for the rest of my days, I will be your slave and your vassal. And I'm going to go into the temple, and I'm going to take all this money, and I'm going to give it to you. And that's exactly what he did. A very bad day. Because guess what happened? They did come in, and they did conquer it. 735 for Syria, and 722 for Israel. Totally wiped out. Now, but in his infatuation with the king, trying to impress him, he takes the false gods of Assyria and puts them in the temple and even sacrifices his own son as a human sacrifice. Paganism was rampant because of that decision. He turned Judah into much more of a pagan nation than it was previously. Consequences. Bad decision. Bad choice. How could you do that? But he did. That was 735 B.C. Now let's move these many years to 701 B.C. And let's go to chapter 36 of Isaiah. And let's see how Hezekiah responded and what he did. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. That's very significant because there was 46 of them. And the king of Assyria sent the Rabshakeh, he's the guy that's next in command to the commander in general of the forces, right under the king, from Lachish, which was the outpost and fortress that was guarding between Egypt, whom they had made an alliance with to protect them, Hezekiah had, against Assyria. And so they were saying, we cut off the Decatur Road, so to speak, for you to have reinforcements. You're not going to have any reinforcements from Egypt. Now, I want to back up just a minute, because here's what happened. Hezekiah sees this tremendous threat. I mean, Ahaz, his predecessor, has already been paying tribute. Hezekiah comes on the scene. He starts paying tribute, just doing what his father had done. Well, he decides he's not going to do that anymore. He rebels against the king of Assyria. He forms this alliance with Egypt, and he stops paying tribute. Assyria responds by doing exactly what I just read. They took 47 of those 45 cities and then were bearing down to take the rest of Jerusalem. Now, you have to go back to 2 Kings to get the chronology here. But I want to read you something in 2 Kings 18, 14 through 16. He says, and King Hezekiah, king of Judah, sent to the king of Assyria at Lachish. Now the king is there at Lachish. They've just taken it. I have done wrong. Withdraw from me. He was saying, I've done wrong in withholding tribute. I've done wrong in making an alliance with Egypt. Whatever you impose on me, I will bear. And the king of Assyria required of Hezekiah, king of Judah, 300 talents of silver, 30 talents of gold. And Hezekiah gave him all the silver that was found in the house of the Lord and the treasuries of the king's house. At that time, Hezekiah stripped the gold of the doors of the temple from the Lord and from the doorpost that Hezekiah, king of Judah, had overlaid, and gave it to the king of Assyria. Now, I want you to see something incredibly powerful here. Yeah, he messed up. Haven't we all messed up? Haven't we all made bad decisions out of fear? That's exactly what he did. But you know what? God gave him another chance. Put it on another platform. And he says, he sent. I want to read on. Now, that gives you the chronology of it. But Hezekiah changes his mind. Why? Let's read. Now, this is the intimidation that's going on, and he's setting the stage for this great transformation in the life of Hezekiah. Verse 2. And the king of Assyria sent Rabshakeh from Lachish and the king to King Hezekiah at Jerusalem with a great army, and he stood by the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the washer's field. And there came out to him Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household, and Shebna, the secretary, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder. In other words, Hezekiah sent his three top guys. Now, Sennacherib had already sent his three top guys. So you got three top guys talking to three top guys, and Sennacherib's three top guys are, trust me, in a better position. Verse 4, and Rabshakeh said to them, say to Hezekiah. In other words, Hezekiah's not there. Royalty didn't show up on these occasions very, very often. Thus says the great king, the king of Assyria, on what do you rest this trust of yours? Do you think that mere words are strategy and power for war? And whom do you now trust that you have rebelled against me? In other words, Hezekiah had a change of heart. He decided he's going to trust God. He decided he was not going to give in to this anymore. And the word's gotten out to Sennacherib, and he sends his guys out there, and here they are responding with taking these cities, and now comes this great contest of words, and what will the outcome be? Five times the word trust is used here in this paragraph. It's amazing. On what do you rest this trust of yours? Do you think that mere words, I want you to keep that in your mind, mere words, are strategy and power for war? I want to just go through these as I read this, because I want you to get the full context of this. Rabshakeh is making some deadly mistakes before God. Here he is basically calling the promises of God mere words. That's a very dangerous thing to do. Mere words are strategy and power for war. And whom do you now trust that you have rebelled against me? Behold, you are trusting in Egypt, that broken reed of a staff which will pierce the hand of any man who leans on it. Such is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all who trust in him. And he was correct. Egypt couldn't do a thing for them now. But if you say to me, we trust, there's that word again, in the Lord our God, is it not he whose high places and altars Hezekiah has removed, saying to Judah and Jerusalem, you shall worship before this altar? Now, he made another tragic mistake. You know what he just did? He doesn't even understand that Hezekiah has had a spiritual renewal. Hezekiah has removed all the false gods that his son put in there. I mean, that his father put in there, Ahaz. And they're lumping Rabshakeh, Sennacherib, and the other guys are lumping together all the gods in one pile. Your God, all these other gods, all in one pile that you've taken out. And to us, a God's a God. There is no difference in any particular God. That's a bad mistake to lump God in with the pile of other gods. Well, let's read on. He says, wager with my master, king of Assyria, and I will give you 2,000 horses. Now, he's been very sarcastic. The Israelites hardly had any horses. If you are able on your part to set riders on them. See his sarcasm? How then can you repulse a single captain among the least of my master's servants? And when you trust in Egypt for chariots and for horsemen, moreover, it is without the Lord. Now listen to this. Moreover, he's asking a question here. Moreover, is it without the Lord that I have come up against this land to destroy it? The Lord said to me, go up against this land and destroy it. Third mistake. He presumes to speak for the Lord and to be doing God's work. Now he's very blasphemous. And then Eliakim, Shebnah, and Joah, those are Hezekiah's guys, said to the Rabshakeh, please speak to your servants in Aramaic. That was the royal language, for we understand it. Now, by Jesus' time, it'd become the plain language. I mean, everybody spoke it. But please speak to your servants in Aramaic, for we understand it. Do not speak to us in the language of Judah within the hearing of the wall of the people who are on the wall. Why did he not want him to do that? Because you're saying intimidating words, it'll make our people fearful. We have to go to war with you guys. Don't make us more afraid. Be polite. Let's be professional about this. Speak in the royal language. That's what we know. And don't speak in the common language of our people. But the Rabshakeh said, has my master sent me to speak these words to your master and to you and not to the men sitting on the wall who are doomed to eat their own dung and drink their own urine? Then the Rabshakeh stood and called out. He gets louder now. In the voice of the language of Judah, hear the words of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus says the king, do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he will not be able to deliver you. Do not let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord by saying, fourth big mistake. God's appointed king cannot be trusted to tell you to trust in God. The Lord will deliver us. The city will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for thus says the king of Assyria, make your peace with me. Come out to me. Now he's encouraging treason, rebellion. Then each one of you will eat of his own vine, and each one of you of his own fig tree, and each one of you will drink the water of his own cistern. Now, that was the biggest blatant lie he'd told so far. The Assyrians I wish I had time to give you Old Testament history. The Assyrians were the most cruel conquerors to date. They put a new meaning. They raised the bar on cruelty to their captives. I'll just give you one instance. They would take a metal rod and they would basically skewer as an example the nobility or members that they wanted to use as a demonstration of the people. They would skewer That just up the entire body of that person and come out the skull. When they transferred their people, which they did in 722, it became history, they would put a metal circle through their nostrils and a rope through it or a chain through it, and that's how they would haul the people and make them stay in line because they didn't want to pull their nose apart. Now, those are not friendly conquerors. Those are not Cyrus the Persian, not by any means. So they're he's lying. It's total lies. Until I come and take you away to a land like your own. Verse 18, beware lest Hezekiah mislead you by saying the Lord will deliver us. Has any of the gods of the nations of his land delivered us out of the hand? See what he's doing again? He's comparing Jehovah God with the gods of the other lands. Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim? Have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Now, I want you to just to see this insight here. This is incredible. This is how far the nation of Israel, now, just think about it, had come, that he was basically saying these pagan lands and Samaria, which was Israel, had the same God. You know what he was basically saying? Your God no longer was the distinctive God of the northern kingdom when we took it. God help America if she's not known anymore as a Christian nation. Now, there's something very powerful here that I want you to get a hold of. The nation that had been taken by Assyria, Assyria was Samaria, which was the northern kingdom. They had lost their identity with the Jehovah God, Yahweh. Verse 20, who among all these gods of these lands have delivered their lands out of my hand that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? In other words, you've got the precedent. You've got the example. You've got the history. You've got the chronology. Do the math, Hezekiah. You ain't gonna make it. Wow. Verse 21, if there was ever any reason for intimidation, it's right here. But listen, but they were silent. Oh, that is so wise. And answered him not a word. Now listen to this. For the king's command was, do not answer him. Now, I want to hold on that. I got something so powerful to tell you on that verse. But then Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household, and Shebna the secretary, and Joah the son of Asaph, recorder, came to Hezekiah with their clothes torn and told him the words of Rabshakeh. At the sign of ultimate blasphemy, a Jew would tear his robe in order to show that someone had defied God. And they all show up with torn clothes. Chapter 37. As soon as King Hezekiah heard it, he tore his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth. And listen to this. Listen to the response that he had in comparison with the response that Ahaz, his father, had. What did he do? He went into the house of the Lord. Of all things, he went to church. He went to the temple. He went to the place where God met them, where his presence was known in the temple. And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, Shebna the secretary, and the senior priest, covered with sackcloth, to the prophet Isaiah, son of Amos. He sent him over to God's man and said, we need help. And they said to him, thus says Hezekiah, the day of distress, of rebuke, and disgrace has come. Children have come to the point of birth, and there's no strength to bring them forth. Pregnant ladies can't even deliver their babies because they're so petrified and terrified. It may be that the Lord your God will hear the words of the Rabshakeh, whom his master, the king of Assyria, has sent to mock the living God. Now, I want you to get a hold of this. Now, this is very powerful. Verse 4. Hezekiah has sent his guys to tell Isaiah this, who represents God and is God's mouthpiece to the king and to the people of Israel, I mean Judea, or Judah. And he says, this is coming out of Hezekiah's mouth. It may be that the Lord your God will hear the words of the Rabshakeh, whom his master, the king of Assyria, has sent to mock the living God, and will rebuke the words that the Lord your God has heard. Therefore, lift up your remnant for your prayer for the remnant that is left. Pray, Isaiah, pray. Blasphemy has come. But I love what he said. It may be. Now, I want you to get a hold of two things here. This is really powerful. Hezekiah realized the real battle was not on the field. It was not on the wall. It was not out there where normal people were thinking and figuring out how many soldiers you've got, how many soldiers we've got, all that. The real battle was not in the presence of this invading army. The real battle was in Hezekiah's faith. The real battle was in his wayward people. The real battle was when they're turning to God. The real battle was their fidelity and their trust in Almighty God. That's where the real battle was. The real calamity was there. And the real battle was in the temple on Hezekiah's knees. Now, this is so powerful that you can't, and he was saying, we don't deserve God to intervene. We do not merit this on the basis of our actions. We have not earned this. Has anybody ever earned it? But listen, you think about Jesus Christ, the cross, the grace, jumping centuries ahead. But listen, he says, it may be that the Lord your God will hear the words of the Rabshakeh. What is he doing? He is applying for, he's appealing to the honor of Almighty God over and above his own security, his own deliverance, his own rescue. He's saying, I want God's reputation to be rescued first before I even think about me. Now, it doesn't get any more powerful than that. Now listen, verse 5, when the servants of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah, Isaiah said to them, say to your master, thus says the Lord, do not be afraid because of the words that you have heard, with which the young men of the king of Assyria have reviled me. He's saying, he's putting God's word in his mouth, or God is. Behold, I will put a spirit in him so that he shall hear a rumor and shall return to his own land, and I will make him fall by the sword in his own land. Don't be afraid. Now, here we are in 701 B.C. In 735 B.C., Isaiah gave the same message to his papa, to his daddy, Ahaz, and he disobeyed it. Now he's given the same message to his son, and the odds are even worse against Hezekiah than they were against Ahaz. Wow, how's he going to respond? The Rabshakeh returned and found king of Assyria fighting against Libna. He's given you, because the Judeans would race ahead, and the king had left Lachish. In other words, the rumor has now become real. And the Sennacherib is left. And now, and he sets out, let's jump down. And when he heard it, he sent messengers to Hezekiah. In other words, the king says, I've got to leave and go take care of Cush, which is a rumor, it's not even true. God just put it out there. And he sent messengers to Hezekiah. Before I leave, this is what I want you to tell Hezekiah. Thus shall you speak to Hezekiah, king of Judah. Do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will be given into the will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Fifth big, final, fatal mistake. Now he accuses God himself of deception. Do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will not be given into these hands. Wow. That's an incredible statement there, Sennacherib. Behold, you have heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all the lands, devoting themselves to what they did. They had a track record. And shall you be delivered? Have the gods of all the nations delivered them in the nations that my fathers destroyed? Gozan, Haran, Reseph, and the people of Eden who were in Telazar? Where is the king of Hamath, the king of Arpad, the king of the city of Sepharvaim, the king of Hena, or the king of Iva? Verse 14, Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it. He's got the word now from both. He's got the word from Sennacherib, and he's got the word from Isaiah. And here he goes. Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord, and I love that, and spread it out before the Lord. That's your response to calamity. Take it to God and spread it out before the Lord. This is where I am, God. I don't have any place to go. I don't have any alternatives. I have nothing but you. What a powerful place to be. And Hezekiah prayed to the Lord. O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim, you are the God, you alone of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Now, he's still got them out there outside the gates. It's not changed. You want to know how to pray? Start with that kind of praise. God, regardless of what's going on here on earth, you are still God of the universe. You reign between the cherubim. You are there now over the kingdoms of the earth that you made to start with. Verse 17. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. How powerful is that? Telling the omniscient, omnipotent, omnipresent God to open his ears and open his eyes. But it was reverent. It was not blasphemous. It was done to appeal to God on the basis of a child of God coming to his Lord. Wow. Hear all the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to mock the living God. This is your reputation, God. I am your king. This is your nation. We are your people. They are enemies to the God of Israel, enemies to the God of Judea. God, we appeal to you to intervene for your reputation's sake. Truly, O Lord, O Yahweh, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations. In other words, I love this. Hezekiah was a realist. He's not burying his head in the sand. He's saying, no, it's true. They've done everything that they said. They've not lied except to say that you're not worthy or that you can't or that you won't. He said, and they have cast their gods into the fire. But listen to that in verse 19. For they were no gods, but the work of men's hands, wood and stone. Therefore, they were destroyed. So now, O Lord, our God, save us from his hand. Here it is, folks, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are the Lord. I cannot tell you anything more powerful than that. Let me tell you something. David, when he prayed in 1 Samuel 17, verses 46 and 47, that all the world will know that you are God in Israel, that this Philistine that has blasphemed the name of the living God, I'll take your head and all the world will know that God is God. That was David's prayer. Moved. 1 Kings, Elijah, chapter 18, verses 36 and 37. 850 against one prophet. What does he pray? Let it be known this day that I am thy servant, that I've done all these things at your name, by your name. Let it be known this name that you're the only God in Israel. Let it be known, God, that you are the true God. And the fire fell from heaven. God is not afraid to be the exclusive God. He's not afraid of exclusivity. He's not afraid of that. Jesus himself said it. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me. Peter said it. In Acts 4:12, there is no other name given under heaven whereby man must be saved. God is exclusive. He rules out all other gods. He is not politically correct. He tells the truth. Unbelievable. When you put yourself on the side of God and you say, God, Shakespeare said it. He said, the world is a stage, and every man must play a part. Now, this is so powerful. God's got a big picture, but he's got little particulars that are open to change. That's where prayer comes in. Hezekiah altered history through his prayers. Moses did the same thing. You said, we can go through Scripture and cite these. Where do you think the power of prayer is? God's got his big plan, but he's got his people out there that are praying and moving in the particulars that God might do something that exclusively demonstrates you and you alone are God. Well, wow. So now, verse 21. Then Isaiah the son of Amoz sent to Hezekiah, saying, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, because you have prayed to me concerning, God's doing a follow-up through Isaiah. Because you have prayed to me concerning Sennacherib, king of Assyria. This is the word that the Lord has spoken concerning him. Now, I'm not going to read you all of this prophecy about Assyria, but it basically says, I'm the one that chose Assyria. I'm the one that let Assyria do what it did. Assyria should have known it was my power all along, but Assyria has become arrogant and proud, and they've become blasphemous and rebellious, thinking it's their own power. Therefore, God is going to put a hook in their mouth, and he's going to take them back by the way that they came. Well, he gives Hezekiah a sign there in verse 30, and he tells him that there's going to be great agricultural prosperity and that they're going to prosper in verse 32. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, out of Mount Zion, a band of survivors. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city. Listen to this. He shall not come into this city or shoot an arrow there. Not only his men were under his control, but every arrow in his arsenal was under God's control. There are come before it with a shield, or cast up a siege against it. By the way that he came, by the way shall he return. He shall not come into this city, declares the Lord. For I will, now listen to this, this is the answer to the prayer. They prayed for God's reputation's sake. Listen. For I will defend this city to save it for my own sake, and for the sake of David, my servant, for the covenant's sake, for my promise's sake, for my reputation's sake. I will intervene in history and do as you have prayed, Hezekiah. Wow. Two kings, two different destinies. Verse 36. And the angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians. And when the people arose up early in the morning, what did they find? Behold, there were dead bodies everywhere, and the Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed, I bet he did, and returned home and lived at Nineveh. And as he was worshiping in the house of Nisroch, his god, Adramelech and Sharezer, his son, struck him down with the sword, and after they escaped into the land of Ararat, Esarhaddon, his son reigned in his place. Boy, you blasphemed God and you said what he couldn't do? Your own God couldn't protect you from your own sons. Wow. Real victory But I want you to get something here. The real battle was not even with the angel that killed the 185,000, nor with the rumor for you to return back and turn around Sennacherib. The real battle was when he went into the temple and he got on his knees and said, God, hear what they've said. And by your namesake and your reputation's sake, God, hear it and have mercy and turn for us. And God did. How powerful. Two choices, two different responses, two different historical outcomes. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning, thanking you, Almighty God, for the fact that you give us the chance to change. We don't have to stay going down the wrong road. Just like Hezekiah, we don't have to keep capitulating. We don't have to keep tucktailing and running. We don't have to keep turning. We can stand up on our knees with you. Standing up to the enemy, kneeling down before you, God. Father, I pray this morning for somebody that's hearing this. They're saying, you don't know where I am. I've got Assyrians everywhere. I'm as outnumbered as Hezekiah was. I've got bills to pay. I've got doctors to go see. I've got kids that I can't control. I've got all things that you could imagine that could happen to a person. But I am a Christian. And I believe in God Almighty. Jesus Christ is my God. And I'm turning to him this morning and saying, God, have mercy on me. For your reputation's sake, that's invested in my life, as poor a display as I have been for you, God, with all of my vacillation, my duplicity, as Hezekiah was, I ask you, Almighty God, to forgive me and intervene for your own namesake and do what only you can do. And Father, we'll thank you and praise you for this. And Father, for somebody out there that's saying, you know what? You're preaching Greek to me because I've never accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. I've never made that decision. I've never seen him as different or exclusive. I've never seen him as more powerful than the other gods that are offered today. I've never seen the contrast until now. Father, would you have the Holy Spirit speak to them in such a way that they cannot resist your grace? And respond by saying, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Forgive me of my sins. Take me to heaven when I die. From this day forward, I turn from my ways. I repent. I put all of my trust in you. And I ask you, God, to take me to yourself. Come inside me and live. And me and you. And Father, we thank you and praise you for those that might have just prayed that right now. We welcome them into the family of God. Father, we pray for you to receive glory and honor in the day in which we live. That is all the things that are taking place, that are transpiring, if we could know it, on a cosmic scale of the principalities and powers that are fighting, we would understand how powerful our prayers are and what a difference they make. God, let us get on our knees and be wise as Hezekiah and make the right choice. And Father, we'll thank you and bless you, for it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you rise, please?
I can feel your eyes on me, Holy God. Your arms ever hold. Faithful one,
broken, empty, overwhelmed, Lord, I come. I can feel your eyes on me.